back to our coverage of the 2015 World Championship Finals. We're going to jump into Game 4 in just a minute, but first we want to check out a couple viewing parties taking place. And we start in the Philippines, where they're doing the wave in between team fights. That's it. We were doing those here, too, in our audience, so it's nice to see some synergy between audiences. Then we'll head to Poland, and the crowd are fired up and following every gink and wombo combo of the showdown taking place in Berlin. But let's get back into the game. You know, I want to focus in on the Ku Tigers. Earlier in the day, we saw a video clip where all they said was, we would like to see a crowd cheer for us just once. Well, they've done it. They secured that first goal.
One of the most epic cheers that I've ever heard.
Too. Yeah, it was
a sweet cheer.
You know, I taught the European audience how to cheer for the Ku Tigers in Brussels. So.
You're not really trying to take credit for this, are you, Monty? You know who it was? It was some fine gentlemen up here in this section who were doing a fabulous job of starting it, and then it erupted around the arena. It really was a lot of fun to be a part of. But if we do turn our attention back to it, 2-1, Ku still has an uphill battle to climb because it's game point for SKT. So they have to use this momentum moving forward. What are going to be their keys to victory? They can't necessarily rely on a 5-1 trade 5 minutes into the game every time around. As much as I'd love to say that's a possibility. What was that?
I'm sure Monty would attest to the fact that Kale style is the win to...
Let's just not go into that at all.
All right, that's fair. I will avoid that for you, Monty. As much trouble as you've given me in life, I will avoid trouble for you. Somebody I want to point to specifically on the team, we did hit on him, Hojin. 89% kill participation today. Highest in the finals so far of any player.
Yeah. He went back in time.
Yeah, and 62% only in the semifinals and before for Hojin. But not only that, it's very important to know that out of all of the Ku Tigers games coming into this World Championship, he was only participating in 2 out of 13 First Bloods in the games that they had played. So very low early aggression, very low kill participation. But man, he has showed up way bigger than I thought he would today.
Yeah, I mean, usually we're talking about Hojin's, you know, extracurricular activities and how he brings so much shot calling to the team. He's the charismatic guy. He keeps everybody upbeat. Nice to see him be able to perform in-game and crush after getting so many early kills.
SKT making their way to the stage right now, taking a little longer than they have between the previous games, so might be indicative of the fact that they have a little bit more to figure out this time around. There are definitely some questions raised, as you mentioned, with their early game, because it is very uncharacteristic of them to fall behind as they did.
I mean, or they're just choosing their weapon and they go like full strong Bella style, where they let them cut you first one time and then smash you anyways.
Because I mean, first one wasn't deep enough.
Yeah, SKT just overall, I think they can easily bounce back because it's really simple to shore up those problems. It's literally like, don't blind invade. And you've seen what you can do when you're playing 10k down. Why not just go even with the Ku Tigers until the mid game? And at that point, you still have the superior shot calling. Yes, you're playing against a team that were renowned as the Comeback Kings, but SKT have shown they have superior mid to late game shot calling. So it's even means ahead for SKT. So that's a very simple strategy to go into. And just at that point, I think the Ku Tigers will just start overextending to match that aggression they had in that victory. And then at that point, it can all come crumbling down relatively quickly.
Now, if they want to do that, though, they're going to have to avoid giving up First Bloods. They've given up 3 today in the series. That's more First Bloods than they've given up the entire World Championship, aside from today. So, again, as you mentioned, they need to... I'll pose this question to you. If that is their goal, looking at Champion Select here, what would be the style of composition that they need to draft and then the play style that needs to accompany it in order to make it through that mid-game?
So loaded question. No, I don't think it matters what they play because they won convincingly with the similar composition game 1.
Okay.
And they just went for the blind aggression. And then, you know, if your combo fails, if your CC is not efficient and not effective, then get the hell out of there. Worst case, sacrifice your support. You're allowed to do that. And then you can walk away and just try it another time. But don't try to chase the loss. This is the first time that we actually saw SKT go into the sunk cost fallacy there, where they just try to chase the loss too much and try to make up for it immediately instead of just taking a step back. Yeah, you know, we misplayed that. Let's go back, get everything even again, start pushing the lane, set up vision, and then make the play again.
All right, well, the teams are ready. We'll see if Ku can do it again. Can they take down the Titans SKT? Let's hand it off to Riv, Jat, and Officio for the play-by-play.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, and we are headed to a game 4. Ku was able to take down SKT, ruining that perfect run-through world so far. It would have been the only one we've ever seen, but it's not going to happen this time. And the Ku Tigers are definitely feeling the love from the crowd. You saw Hojin possibly on your screen kind of pumping everybody up as that Ku Tigers chant started again during the analyst desk. They are really feeling the love And as a team that works together when things are on the up and up, I'm sure they're going to be doing well this game.
Yeah. And what's been happening in these early games? Because it is consistently Ku coming up with some pretty big edges. Here, though, we have to refocus on the pick and ban phase because Fiora
absolutely
and Lulu have been potentially changing in priority throughout this series.
Well, there she is.
Okay, so SKT, now with their three super strong champions they normally ban still left open, Elise, Mordekaiser, and Gangplank, we'll have to leave one of them or all of them open for the Ku Tigers. Now, Hojin just showed up on Lee Sin big time. Is that enough to make SKT say we don't need to ban Elise because he can do it on Lee Sin anyway? Maybe that's what they're thinking here. Because we would expect Mordekaiser now to be the last one, especially because they banned the Gangplank.
Yeah.
Ku Tigers should have.
We also don't see the Kench yet.
Ban the Kench now, first big Elise.
This is fascinating. There are more power picks open right now than we've seen previously.
Ooh.
And even more are three now. Mordekaiser, Elise, Lulu. We think Lulu is deprioritized due to not having much success so far in this series.
Tom Kench.
Kench and Elise.
Bring in the Kench.
That's basically what SKT is doing here.
Or do you take Elise? Yeah. With Rek'Sai still on the board, I think you can trade the junglers mostly, even though Elise is still fairly superior.
I go Tom Kench, man.
Yeah.
They do too. I like it.
Which means SKT will then go Elise and still have the option for Lulu.
Only thing I would have seen change from the Ku Tigers is instead of maybe banning the Rumble, obviously because the CD Fiora ban, they're like, okay, we want to keep target top laners. It was very difficult for Ku Tigers then to realize, okay, are we going to get in a trade where it's like Elise and Tom Kench for each other? They could maybe ban away one of them. Because SKT were very locked in their bans. When you first ban Fiora on red side and have GP and Mordekaiser open still, you're pretty much forced to go for those two bans. Ku Tigers could have played around it. Instead, they are apparently happy taking the Tom Kench, who is, in my opinion, a step above every other support. Same for Elise, obviously, when it comes to junglers. But man, Tom Kench can make so many sick
We've
plays.
We've seen it so many times with Jinx. Bang has zero plays through Summer or Worlds on Jinx, so that's pretty much falling into the hands of Prey if they actually want it. Alistar also picked up with that Elise. We'll see what they can put on the table. They've got a bit of crowd control to start off some fights if they can grab somebody from afar, but it's still the Ashe pickup. The arrows just too strong.
This is the Ku Tigers' favorite bottom lane. Because what you will do is you will push out your lane, you will recall, and then you have an arrow and you have the Tom Kench ulti to gank whatever lane you want. And suddenly five members appear behind Faker or Marin. That's a kill, that's a tower. Something Ku Tigers love to do, and they can do this with this comp.
And they also save their solo lanes until the very last pick. So the Gnar's not going anywhere but top lane. Smeb gets to try and counterpick that, but without Fiora on the board.
He can still take a Riven.
Yeah, I'd expect Riven into Gnar.
Into the Gnar if he wants to. I mean, he can play an Olaf something into Gnar as well, but obviously he doesn't have to set up with his team, so Riven would work fine for him in this matchup. Overall, just the Ku Tigers are getting comfort picks across the board, and I felt like in game two as well, they got a very good composition for the Ku Tigers. They're doing the same thing here. SKT obviously can be still be happy getting Elise as your first pick here. Bengi needs to show up in this game and out jungle Hojin, who's obviously been giving a lot of kills in the early game. It's made it easier for Hojin to show up today.
Hojin's eruption in game three was kind of the least expected thing we have at Worlds. He was so walked over in so many of the bracket stage games already.
Not gonna.
It could. Maybe. I mean, would we see
Lulu
Smeb?
Top?
Smeb on Lulu top?
That's actually true. I was going to say, no, they have a support, but
hasn't been the case for a long while.
But you have the tools.
The team composition for SKT also does fit pretty well with the Lulu, so it could be a denial pick.
Cassid and Lulu, are they looking to make the AP happen that way for
the
team? It is locked in, so Lulu is going towards that top lane for Smeb. Gorilla is going to be giving that Kassadin over to Kuro. We'll see what SKT has for their counter pick here.
So now
it is going to be
just,
for Faker.
You just blind picked Kassadin as well.
Yeah, that.
I'm just going to throw it out
glad
there.
You pointed that out.
Faker is the guy who wants to play Riven mid. Just pointing it out. Obviously,
we want him to play Riven.
There will be a lot of physical damage if he goes for it. He does have an AP jungler. At
That's
least.
A good point. That's
but
good
now
point.
Again, he has the opportunity to counter pick this Kassadin. Unless we're going to see some flexing going on and Kassadin suddenly goes to the top lane.
He's definitely
not expecting that one.
I was just going to say it.
Just to note, all games Smeb has played in 2015, he's played 8 Lulu games, 5 wins, 3 losses, so it's not something completely foreign to him. It's just not what we'd expect out of Ku so far at Worlds. Lulu top lane was something that Stake played in the group stages, and then after that, it's pretty much been in the mid lane.
Yep.
Yeah.
And now we get to see Faker's Rise. when you push Faker's champion pool, he just goes back to Ryze, I suppose.
Why not? It's been open every game
so far. Well, if you look at what he's played in solo queue, he's like AD carry top lane. Oh, jungle ones. Oh, play a support. He's everywhere. You can't scout this guy. So he just goes back to the Ryze, even if he does have to reach into that pocket even deeper for a game five.
And this is such a fine lane for Faker because the Cassidy never really has the ability to be too aggressive unless you have full control of the enemy jungle. Because whenever you jump in as the Cassidy, he can just pop his ulti on Ryze and you can just spam snare and you can literally lock this guy in place and he cannot use his mobility, which is what Cassidy does so well. It's also going to be a free farm lane for Faker. He can bring teleport. This is the time now where SKT suddenly will have the map pressure. Kuro is bringing Ignite once again on the Cassidy. So they cannot start falling behind because they will not be able to stop what's going to happen in the side lanes. We know Gnar is going to be really, really strong as well as a spike pusher.
And this is another one of these matchups, though, where Ku Tigers brings global ultimates in support and jungle, whereas SKT will then bring the extra teleport in the mid lane. It's the same juxtaposition we saw in game one, just swapped for which teams had the globals.
We're going to see what happens. Loading up for game four with the Summoner's Cup on the line. Tweet hashtag KOO win or hashtag SKT win to at LOL Esports. We'll be tallying your votes up throughout the game to see where you stand on this one. I'm sure coming into the game or even right after the game, maybe one of the first things Koma said was the perfect record doesn't matter. The win still does. Shake that off. Get into game. Ku, however, riding a wave of momentum coming into this one. It's exactly what they wanted from the crowd and from themselves. And they stand in a very good position to take another game.
If they say that most players don't care about these 18-0s or 13-0, whatever it is you're aiming for, they just want to win the whole thing.
Yep.
It's more the Costas who care about who you are defeated.
All that will matter is which team hoists the Summoner's Cup.
That's exactly right.
That is so beautifully on display on the stage right there. And SKT, just like they were in game three, are one game away.
It still hangs
from
in the balance.
Moment. And for Faker and Bangi, it would be their second time doing such. And they would be the first people to ever have that privilege to do it twice.
And now we get to see a thing I didn't expect. Smet on a supportive champion. Because the whole reason this meta fit Ku Tigers so well was that Smet could take Riven and Fiora into the top lane. He would outduel the enemy top laner and do really, really well. We haven't seen him show up too much this time around. Last game, he needed 30 minutes of farming. Then we saw a big play. It was massive and allowed Ku Tigers to win the game, obviously. But now he's on supported champions that can't really snowball. That's one of the problems about Lulu. TP ganks are not very effective for her. Ganking her lane doesn't do a whole lot. You'd rather want to leave the Lulu alone and just let her sit and farm up.
It's true, and actually before the last game, it had been a really long time since Ku Tigers had defeated SKT. I mean, you mentioned the summer split that they were 0-4.
Yeah.
They were 3-0'd in the spring final. They were 2-0'd later on in their second best of three in the spring split. But in doing that, how much will that get in the mind of SKT? They need to be able to bounce back.
Speaking of records, the last time SKT even dropped one game in a series was in August against Najin EM Fire, so it's not something they're really used to right now. You can see Ku's momentum wave flowing right into the crowd as they wave around the Mercedes-Benz Arena.
SKT has done this before, where they leash for either Bengi or Marin to get him quickly to level 2, and then he can go to his lane, and he kind of has a small advantage. You see him get the grump now. It got delayed a little bit because Ku Tigers invaded, but that was very smart. He's gonna kill it, I mean.
Half a second away, actually, from not killing that thing. They know he's gonna be recalling, so Smeb will be able to make it up there level 2.
Yeah.
Either of the bottom lanes actually gain experience off that.
And Smeb can run, because he started on top side of the map. It's very important in these matchups here. If you start on the top side as the jungles, and top lane duo, taking that camp, get level 2, even got blue buff on the side of Smith. You can run up there and save your teleport. Because Marin had to do this play around the Grump, wanted to try and rush it down and then team it up. He's now down a summoner spell, and that's going to be key when it comes to poking away. You can always go back to the turn.
And even though Smeb has been performing so well on carry top laners, it's not like he hasn't been effective on utility or tank type top laners in the past. 5-3 this year on Lulu. He was a good Maokai player. He was a great Gnar player. He can still play those styles. It's just more throwback for Ku Tigers and kind of a mix of the old and the new with this team composition.
A lot of Korean players, when you're on Incredible Miracle, you don't really perform too well. But when he leaves, a lot of the players tend to do really, really well. Smith is one of the guys. He didn't have much of a name before he joined the Ku Tigers. And then slowly but surely got better.
Was considered one of the worst top laners previously. So a very big step up for him. you heard the Korean casters saying it was almost impossible that SKT themselves slumped, but each player on KU Tigers has faced that individually and then come back to be fantastic players here at Valorant Worlds, aiming for the summer spot.
And this game will also be so much about how SKT can recover from the early game. You can see Bengi missing his cocoon on the Scuttle Crab. Not the best start, losing some early pressure there because that revealed him to Gorilla and Prey as well. SKT really needs to kind of reset, make sure they're safe in the early game, and then make KU beat them.
Have to keep an eye this game if they do kind of forego the sight stones again, use the hawk shot, get their vision through different means, or if they go back to kind of a regular play. The aggression they had last game took SKT off guard, but I'm sure SKT is ready for that another time.
Yeah, for sure. They've been talking about the first 5 minutes. We haven't seen SKT rush into the enemy jungle all of a sudden and take a stupid fight. We just saw a jungler miss on the wrist button.
Much more patience.
That was about it. That's about the amount of action we've seen so far. So it's a lot slower pace now. There is a lane that's going to be annoying for them. I always liked Ashe into Sivir because of the fact that you can just constantly trade her with her. It's very hard for Sivir to trade back these quick trades. You're just going to boomerang you step to the side. But when that happens, Time Kench will eat the Ashe. Then suddenly the trade damage is really going. There we go. Thank you very much, by the way, KU Tigers, for showing it. So you can have these very quick trades.
Exhibit
then
A.
You get that level 6 and you can start making plays across the map.
Well, wave kind of sitting in their favor here. If there any is jungle pressure down bottom, Hojin is there, but there is going to be no presence of Bengi as the wave kind of crashes in and starts to build.
Yeah, and there was a slight early edge in that lane for KU because SKT did try and pull for Marin, but we're not seeing the fruits of that labor in any of the lanes. The top lane is still losing to Smeb, although it is small, and then Prey and Gorilla, even with the wave being in their turret, were up about 8 or 9 CS, so nice stuff all around. Hojin, though, he sees...
It's a pretty risky invade. Bengi just pulled off. He
moved
it on his own. Kassadin couldn't move down. The lane was pushed in. Gorilla and Prey down here is having control of the 2v2 as well. They could easily have collapsed on Bengi, but they didn't see him before it was too late. He got very early side stuff. As if you deep wards down, that's going to be important at least, so he gets away with it.
Yep.
That could have been very, very risky.
Using that blue buff as much as possible to make sure Marin stays down, activating his Gnar off the minion wave as well so he can't get pressure, but Marin just dodged, didn't take too much damage. Another condition that SKT will have to fight under is that Gnar bar. We'll see how they get around that once the time comes. A very early sight stone for Bengi to get more vision in. Looks like Hojin runs towards the mid lane, but Faker go back, so they're not going to get anything out of it.
Low on mana.
Not in a great spot. He's been pushing with that blue buff. Without it now, he gets himself out. The repel does not hit.
That's exactly what Smeb needed to do right there. So often you see Lulu's greed and not successfully flash the cocoon away there, but he knew he couldn't speed himself up very well. You knew he was low on mana, and it's just... Aside from getting caught in the first place because you're pushed up at 6.5 minutes without wards, the gank escape was perfectly done.
A little bit annoying for Bengi as well. He knew the minion wave was coming. He's like, either I fire the cocoon now, or the minion wave will arrive and I can't do it and he can hide behind them and so on. But pulling the trigger.
Well, that flash is down. Bengi wants to at least get coverage up here, or since Marin is pushed up pretty low health, they want to see if Hojin's going to make a move. Hojin, however, likes to counter gank himself, so make him up here very, very slow. Not get himself in any trouble. Actually goes down bottom, knows Smeb is safe. He's going to get some vision of his own inside the jungle.
This is a little...
At least knowledge.
This is a little bit more of the Rakka stage Hojin that was looking ineffective. He's wasted a lot of time so far in this game. Not only in the bottom lane beforehand, when the ward is spotted him by Bengi, the ward guard is in place, he canceled his recall, cleared an extra ward, went back to base, and then a very late counter gank attempt in the top lane when Smeb really could have even died since he just teleported back to his turret at absolute full health. Some inefficiency is coming up.
And as soon as you show yourself as a jungler in the early game, you give so much information to the other team. Because, okay, he's topside. Suddenly, it's open for you to go into the enemy jungle on the bottom side. You want to reduce some of the wards. You can keep control that way. So whenever a jungler wastes time assuring how they can shoot at, it ends up costing more in the long run because of their vision you lose.
And one of the bigger costs of that is the fact that Faker still gets to farm up freely on Ryze. He knew it was going to be an easy lane. But when he's able to dodge the jungle pressure so easily, he's gone tier into a mana crystal. He's going to be going Catalyst next, but he is completely maxing out on damage early on here.
And you can see it's almost told as well. If you look
Super
at the
dangerous
items in the side of Smeb and Kuro, they both have Catalyst. which means they'll be doing stacking as well. The cocoon comes out. Hojin flashes in and gets the knockup, saving Smeb's life. Can they retaliate here? It looks like Bengi and Marn have gone too far away, but what a save for Smeb.
A lot of things happened right there. Faker tried to TP in behind his ult, but Coral managed to interrupt the teleport from Faker, and then obviously we had this no flash Lulu running from the river. SKT thinking, oh, this is gonna be a kill, and Hojin shows up to save the day.
Everyone had to do the right thing to avoid dying there, which is a little bit dangerous.
Flashes were blown in the mid lane as well. Looks like Faker and Kuro went hard, so there's no flash for this. Hojin in a real bad situation with the last bit of mana. Faker takes him down 2v1.
This was one of the problems we mentioned a little bit in Champ Select, how Kassadin in the early game with the Catalyst, he can't really burst down the Ryze. And then whenever you jump in for any fights, Ryze can just turn it around.
I figured there wouldn't be any fights right now. You're going up against Faker, charging things up. Of course he knows how to play that. And it's a tell to have two Catalysts to say, we want to hang.
And it remains to be the greatest mystery of worlds, how Faker's the only one playing Ryze in the mid lane.
But I think it really is.
We're learning more and more about why that's the case. It really feels like he's the only one that truly understands Ryze. Because that was easy for Faker. He burned the Ignite in a 1v2 and got an easy kill.
And Flash was already down from a 1v1 that they just had as the teleports went towards top, so.
Yeah, really bad
playing
game
it
by
very well.
And Kuro there.
So Koo Tigers in the last few games, on average at 10 minutes, they were 1,084 gold ahead of SKT. This game, we have not seen the same SKT run in head first and just risk losing members, giving up kills they shouldn't have in the early game. They're playing a lot slower. Bengi's been getting some deep wards, and this time around, it's SKT who has the lead at 10 minutes. We also know they have the better late game shot calling.
Yes.
As a team, we have seen that now. Suddenly, it's looking a lot different.
Very controlled from SKT, not trying to get themselves into crazy engages behind tier 2 turrets at the start of the game. Already setting the pace that they want and that they can control.
Yeah, and here's what SKT is trying to do. They want Faker to scale up a little bit more into a Rod of Ages. They want Marn to stack magic resist so he's nearly unkillable by the Lulu and Kassadin. Those are two very low sustained damage mages, and Ashe doesn't do big damage until later in the game.
We're gonna fight a mid though.
Oh,
it's behind them.
Wolf comes up the river behind everyone. The arrow into Bang is actually spell shielded nicely. So all for all there, but the turret is saved in mid lane.
And I really like this play here from Koo Tigers. When you play against a Kassadin or a Ryze, things that can't easily clear the wave, you can then fight it close, or Faker would have to use Zolti and then the next wave you would be able to clear it out. You gotta be able to move in your AD carry and your support to that mid lane, pressure that tower, because so often you get so much free damage before the other team reacts and sends their AD carry to defend. Koo Tigers have pushed out the bottom lane. We mentioned how with the Ashe and Tahm Kench, they can have these globals to move to the other lanes, send them straight mid lane, get a lot of damage before Bang reacted, and SKT has to fight then to stop the push.
And this is where SKT plays the best. So many flashes were blown from Prey and Gorilla on the last fight. They know they're safe to do this, and they start taking the advantages little by little. Hojin gets pushed out by the ultimate of Faker in the mid lane. He actually should be okay here with the blue buff. Room person back on Akuro, and every pick is safe. Again, Dragon number one goes to SKT.
Really easy Dragon 2. Smeb didn't have the teleport up in the top lane. Faker's beginning to manhandle this mid lane.
Thistle Voyage towards mid.
This isn't to kill
pressure,
Faker, this is
pressure.
To kill the turret. They already know the turret is low and Faker can't clear the wave well.
Exactly the same play we just saw before from Koo Tigers. They know Faker on the Ryze cannot lead. He already used the ulti. Safe play from Koo Tigers. Very low risk and obviously gives a great reward because you get a mid tower down in 12 minutes. So I really like those two plays, and it's one of the things that Tahm Kench offers. Let's see what happens here. Marn is going for Smeb.
And this is one of the first games where we haven't seen the side lanes drop yet. The middle goes down first. We'll see how that opens up the map right now. That wet noodle fight in the top lane. Looks like Hojin wants to participate. Gnar's back Smeb, so he can't slow him anymore. But the pop-up from Hojin may keep him in range. Smeb does have flash. Will he utilize it? I think Marn's made too much ground already, and he gets out safe.
They were thinking about going hard up there. Curl already roamed halfway up the lane, which leaves this window. Wolf can dive on Alistair. He has his ult.
That's the hit. Gorilla's going to be pushed back, but that's a lot of gray health he has to work with to get out of this situation. Pops it at the last second, and beautiful. Wolf waits until the last moment when he can headbutt. No Gorilla's flash is down and make it look easy.
Good decision from Wolf going for the Tahm Kench. Don't go for the AD carry. He can just eat him then and keep him alive.
Sometimes it's ill-advised, but they know what they're doing.
Go for the support here. Take him down. Take the tower as well. Marn is still up in the top lane trying to defend. There's the teleport from Faker.
He's gonna need help. Yeah, there comes Faker. Really nice timing on that teleport.
TP and ult as he makes his way out there. Getting a few stacks on the... Oh, wait a minute. He's going to be in range a little bit more. Spams out those rune prisons. That's the tower hitting. Marin trying to give him the time of day, but it's a hit from Faker. The teleport and flash. Hashtag worth.
And right here is why Faker makes Ryze work. He knows exactly when he can flash forward and just unleash his entire combo, keep you basically locked in place.
The fact that he knew he could gap close the entire lane against the Lulu is incredible.
Yeah, you have very small windows of power on Ryze, and Faker is able to show up in these situations where the enemy isn't tracking the Ryze cooldowns as well as Faker is. And really, his flash to kill ratio on Ryze is nearing 100%.
All the time.
It's truly impressive.
Nicely played by Marin to escape any danger there from Kuro. Been roaming a little bit, now loses pressure on his mid lane. We'll see if he can get back quickly. Faker's already there stacking it up, so SKT could be pressuring mid now.
Praying Gorilla should have been mid already. Now they end up having to use the ulti here. Let's see what happens.
Oh, hello, the AD carry Abyssal Voyage. Gorilla and Prey come popping out as Hojin on the other side, and that's going to call Marin down, so a little bit of a fight in the mid lane that nobody wants to take until everyone arrives.
When you play with a Cassidy, as soon as the laning phase seems to be over and we have these roams happening, skirmish all over the place, you need to get that Cassidy away from the mid lane. Because again, he will not be able to defend if SKT groups on him. So you have to move Ashe and Top Kench earlier to mid lane, so you don't have to use the ulti here from Gorilla either. You have that now global pressure because Top Kench goes either lane with his ulti, and he can take Prey with him, or Hojin with him if needed. But you need that AD carry to sit with the supporter to be the defensive mid. Obviously, it's not insane wave clear from an Ashe, but at least long range. Mm-hmm. Bang now gets a lot of time in front of him because two Tigers just had to move Cassidy in top, then move AD carry mid, very delayed. They were constantly a step behind, and that's what SKT has used.
Exactly. Cassidy and Ashe, when you compare that to just to Sivir and Ryze, Ryze and Cassidy, Ryze would actually have a little bit better wave clear than the Cassidy, but Sivir's much better than the Ashe.
Yeah.
They're playing the pressure game. This is the game that SKT had a huge compositional advantage in game three, but then we're getting picked off too many times. But the conservative nature of what SKT is doing with the windows of aggression is more the SKT that we saw in game 22.
And you're gonna see SKT move Ryze down to the bottom lane and then keep the Sivir in mid lane. So you now have three lanes basically pushing for you. Sivir can instant wave clear in here. Mid always get it down to towers of Prey stuck there, defending their full vision of where Prey is on the map. Ryze, it's not going to be challenged by anyone in a 1v1. We've seen what happens when Cassidy jumps forward. Lulu is not going to do it. So there's going to be three lanes where SKT can push them down. That means they can be proactive outside of two Tigers trying to fire an arrow and surprise them. But then SKT should be in a position where they push up the lane, we can see it happening, and react to double teleport themselves.
Many mistakes are made at the same time. They'll get way more than just one turret in that situation. SKT takes a mile when you give them an inch. 3-0 already. This time, they have the 2,000 gold lead, and we did see the early sight stones coming in from Ku this time. It wasn't just the run into the jungle, find a target, and make it happen. They don't have that pick anymore to get to work with.
Sivir with the spell shield, it's hard to catch out for the Ashe. So if you want to make that play,
Bang's been so good at spell shielding it.
Exactly, and you have Wolf as well with his ult. So, not really any target you're aiming for mid lane. Just be propel up in the air.
Yeah, a lot of denial there.
Mainly, they're trying to hit Faker, who's going to be having some resiliency of his own with the Rod of Ages being completed. And the Seraph's Embrace going to come online pretty soon as well. So the arrow targets have to be pretty tricky. Maybe they'd have to hit Bengi before he can repel up.
Could be one of them.
But it's harder for Ku to find the kills in this game, and their aggression has definitely been toned pretty far back in the last.
And we looked again at this double teleport. Marin once again has gone for the storm very early on. Less cooldown on the teleport. He was one of the first guys to really start bringing home guard when TP top became a big thing, and he was so good at Maokai and so on, always creating flanks with it. Now he's changed that. Distortion is that less cooldown has more value for him in this game. So double TP.
Yeah.
Less cooldown on one of them, stronger side lanes as well.
Well, I also think it's just a smart adaption to the way the game is being played. So much of the teleports are matching each other's teleports. So when you match, if Marin has distortion boots, his is up sooner, and they can then win that play.
But Smep should have noticed that, and he can copy it and do exactly the same. We've seen three games in a row now from Marin. And if it's going to be a problem, which it will be because, again, the cooldowns are so important, I feel like you can adapt on the fly.
Are they going to dive top? I was going to say Hojin spending a little too much time there for just a ward, but looks like they do decide to go with it. But they're giving SKT way too much time. Also, a teleport is still up for Faker. They're fighting the other teleport in Marin, but they don't have a minion wave. SKT has already mobilized themselves towards top.
And I think another thing we haven't talked about, as we saw with Smeb and Marin, just like slapping each other very weakly. Super tank Marin. Kuro can't create any opportunities on his own against Ryze, and Ash isn't exactly your dueling AD carry. Ku Tigers really needs to wait a long time before this team composition comes online, and they're actually at the mercy of a lot of the power spikes from SKT thus far.
Faker realizes he is sitting right on a ward, hatching it, and the team wants this right now. Doesn't look like Ku's gonna get much, and they lose pressure in the top lane. Smeb went to TP, but he did not go, so he gets this turret.
Because SKT keep pushing down all three lanes to the towers of Ku Tigers, they can see as soon as people are missing. Like, oh, you just left mid lane? Let's make sure our top laner is aware. Let's make sure Faker can teleport up in case it's needed. And we saw all other members from SKT already run through their own jungle towards that top lane in case a dive would happen. I would like to see Brainstead recall run Ash from the base and then fire an arrow down the lane here. That's very hard to dodge unless you have flash off. And it's also a lot harder to predict. Okay, where is he going? Is he going top? Is he going bottom lane? If he moves from mid lane after playing a wave, SKT sees it.
Such an advantage as well now with Faker having that teleport up. Kuro has to respect the bottom lane push, so he's forced to rift down as the rest of the team tries to hold off middle. Marin's gonna go ahead and pick up red, and that will just create more of a possibility for SKT to kind of reel in these kills. Just farming it up. Marin against the blue buff Lulu, still up in CS there in the lane. By a few, he's doing what he can to stay in this game.
Strong Gnar play, good build in the situation he's in too, because he knows it's gonna be a very long time before Kray can sufficiently hurt him. Nice steal by Vengi right now.
That hurts.
Yeah, SKT is systematically kind of just taking away Ku's win conditions. They're keeping the waves pushed up, the teleports from Smeb are failed, the Tahm Kench, if he ever goes missing, SKT is able to fall backwards. And they too scale very well. Faker on Ryze will be a late game monster, so they're really making Ku commit into these pretty risky plays in which they haven't been willing to. Honestly, Frey is still sitting on Infinity Edge component, so it's gonna take a long time.
Marin,
who tries to make this close.
Not really worried about those fights, worried about being a tank. Steric's gauge, first item.
I think it's great when you have a Sivir, when you have an Alistar, something that can set up the fight for you and help you stay in there, give you extra mobility, because you become such a monster once you're in the middle of the fight, and obviously the shield pops, you get the extra AD for yourself. That's gonna make him really hard to deal with in the fights. And obviously, again, he's not afraid of the Lulu killing him. He has enough magic resist. I have such a weird feeling with Lulu top lane, because again, it can't really snowball, it can't really assert a whole lot of pressure either. It just wants to go into team fights, but you want to have a split push ready in this meta. So it's always been a bit of a weird pick, and that's why we've seen it a lot less here this World Championship. I definitely didn't expect it to expect.
Vax against the wall, Fiora not in his champion pool there because it was banned away, so I understand why they went for it in this situation, because they had so much success in game 3 by going with something completely different, a full pick composition. And they are stalling this game out as well. SKT as well as Ku Tigers are kind of playing the slow game.
Yeah, simply just not been able to create the pick in this game because Frey is always spotted where he goes. He's not been able to roam around in this Ash here. Double teleport makes it so difficult because all three lanes have always been pushing down, slowly chipping away on the power.
Faker hitting that Seraph's Embrace as well. He's going to be even harder to kill now. 10 stacks towards Kuro's Rod of Ages. Smeb is almost there. So those items coming online now as they put a few more in their pocket. Faker almost at 10 stacks on his. This is going to get very, very volatile quite soon. Level 11's are on the board. That means they have their second ultimate. Dragon is going to be up in a minute 40. Be a perfect time to get more summoners or alts out of members of SKT here. 22 minutes in to 3,000 gold deep for SKT with two dragons already in their favor.
Yeah, and this could turn into a 3-4, maybe even 5 dragon stall game for SKT. It'll be really interesting to see when Ku Tigers tries to contest the dragon, because they really haven't been in strong position to do so. They do have two Rod of Ages though, stacking up pretty heavily.
Yeah.
When they get a death cap onto Smeb, if they get a death cap onto Smeb, and when Kuro completes his Zhonya's, is there opportunity to create a fight?
It is, and that's what they have to pull off. The problem is, SK Telecom, they have no reason to rush in and take a 5-on-5 team fight. Again, when you have the map pressure, you just keep pushing the lanes, and you wait for that moment where Ku Tiger sends someone down to defend the bot lane tower, and then you make a play on the opposite side of the map. But that's where you rush the dragon while Kassadin is sitting and clearing waves at his own tower down here on the bottom side. And then you always have that small advantage coming into the fight. SKT suddenly just rushes Dragon for absolutely no reason. That's where Ku Tigers will have an opening. Land an arrow, get the engage, try and win that fight.
Seeing how SKT could play this one. Marin in the top lane, looking to build that bar. It'd be a great time in 30 seconds to have that Gnar out. Faker and Kuro already on the bottom side of the map, adding that pressure. With Dragon coming up, you can already see Gorilla kind of waiting in the middle of both top and mid, or I should say bottom and mid.
Remember his home guard, and he's sitting in base for a long time now. He's waiting to TP somewhere. He's going to get right now.
Just going into the river brush, but it's going to be Kuro getting dropped immediately. How did he even think he could take that fight? Saris Embrace wasn't even used by Faker, and they're ready to keep going for the fight. Gorilla chomps up Smeb as his teleport comes in. Prey gets caught way off on the wing here. Ku was not ready to take any sort of fight. They thought it'd be a single 1v1 with their TP being the advantage of the bottom lane, but they have been turned on their head for this engage. Marin, no red buff, just the slows from the boomerang, but it looks like Ku is able to stave off any more deaths. Two for nothing there for SKT.
Ku has no idea how to deal with Faker. That is the thing that is losing them this game. 4-0-1, 100% kill participation. And also, two of those kills were 1v2s. And he didn't even have to burn flash while killing them. This is a big misplay by Ku to be walking in range of Faker when he's capable of doing that. Faker has complete mastery and knowledge of what he can do. And you can tell Ku has none of that knowledge.
I just love this matchup here. It was last picked, the Ryze into the Kassadin. Kassadin shines when he uses his mobility, get multiple ultis off, but Ryze is able to lock him in place and burst him out. Keep in mind, you're also a champion who wants to build Hourglass second item. There's nothing against the Ryze. He just got completely destroyed.
Tahm Kench was trying to come in for a larger flank. That's why the Kassadin engaged.
Oh, yeah.
He was interrupted on the other side of the fight.
They had Homeguard TP coming, they had Tahm Kench coming, everything was set up. But you need to get that arrow in first to stun that Ryze, because we see what Faker can do. The amount of damage he's pulling off already.
Can't let him freewheel like that.
And again, a game they're building. The face of the mountain fully, it looks like, on Gorilla. Merc treads around, so they have what they need in magic resistance instead of building that Aegis. The locket's already completed for Bengi. They're not worried about any of that AP damage, so Faker can still wreak havoc on these members of Ku. It's not looking good, and we've said Faker, Playmaker really hasn't been here this world. He's just waiting for the final points.
I think he's been having a great final so far.
See what happens here, Gorilla. He's caught.
The gray health is there, a flash over the wall possibly. Doesn't even get a chance to gray health on that one. A good crit from Bang and the execution from Bengi. And it looks like a little too far into the turret as they're getting flanked by Kuro here. SKT still knows their limits, and they get one kill there and have mid pressure.
The walls are crashing down around Ku.
For sure.
Right.
Playtime is over.
Yeah, Marin is also unburstable for the most part with the Steric's Gauge as well as the tank items. The team is engaging in the right moments. The waves are crashing down on Ku Tigers. They don't even have Ash Hour right now. SKT is in complete control and look to be on their way to their second world champion.
And this is where SKT does their best work. When their opponent's being smothered, they don't know how to assess a fight. They don't know where to go once the fight starts. And SKT continues to pick you off one by one, grabbing a little bit after that. It looks like they were looking for a few more kills there as they enter the jungle with the Tigers. Coming up empty-handed, they're still happy to be in the lead with all the map pressure right now.
And what a mental recovery by SKT. They died 29 times in game three to the Ku Tigers, and 26 minutes into this game, they are yet to suffer a casualty. Undefeated throughout all of Worlds. Play kind of badly in game two, early game comeback. Play even worse in game three, get beaten. The crowd is completely against them at the end of that game. Ku Tiger chance coming in, and they are playing close to a flawless game four.
Very, very clear after the game. Sit down, took extra time before they even returned to the stage.
Yeah, they did.
And just talked over and said, okay, guys, we have absolutely no reason to risk this early game. We know what we can do later on in the game. Play it safe. Doing it this game here. Double teleport coming in. Ku Tigers also surprising us again in a bigger man phase. This time around, I definitely feel like it was for the worse, especially when it came to this Lulu pick in the top lane. The first three picks were great. Rek'Sai, Ashe, Tahm Kench looked really good for Ku Tigers. Then it was a blind pick casted in, and it was
it's just going to mention
lane.
That. Coming in maybe a little too strong headed there. Obviously, still could have worked. Seen the blind pick Kassadin's come out very strong, but Faker knows exactly what that matchup is about. Pulling out the Ryze one time after the other, continues to play it to great success.
Yeah, and comparing the team compositions between game three and four for Ku Tigers, game three, everyone was a playmaker. Lee Sin for Hojin. Ashe and Kassadin still the same, but they had split push pressure from Smeb on Fioric and a Thresh for Gorilla. Tahm Kench is an annoying support. He's mainly a defensive user.
He's beautiful.
And then he punishes positional errors, but he's not the same type of playmaker that Thresh is. So substantially less playmaking for Ku. And that's one of the great things. They kind of threw caution to the wind.
Oh, boy.
But now SKT is playing their defensive control game. This is their risk.
Teleport almost up for Smeb on this one. He's clearing the bottom wave. It looks like the team may not even try to take anything. Hoja gets hit out. A very late arrow, though, still allowing SKT to fight. The Gnar misses off of a flash there by Gorilla, but Baron is now up, and the fact that the waves are already crashing towards Ku makes this so much more difficult for them.
Remember, it's a home guard enchant. For Smeb, cooldown, or more cooldown. For Hojin.
Again, where they take different roads to exit. The exhaust is there, but I don't think they're going to have the chase on that, even with Faker's ultimate coming in. It looks like they stay back. Ku now trying to hold off mid. The flash was used by Prey, or I'm sorry, heal was used by Prey. The TP coming in to save the minion as well as engage in a fight. Smeb gets the wild gold on himself. What a static shiv crit. And it looks like that could be a final kill. Nicely done coming in. The toxin from Bengi picking up a kill onto Prey as he had already used heal. He could not get himself away. And Gorilla also falls after flashing previously.
And SKT's going to take a lot after this one. The wave clear is gone for Ku Tigers. They had to go back to base. They have Baron buff and five people alive for SKT.
How hard did they push this in? They don't have many waves pushing the side. It could be towards the top before Prey and Gorilla get up to get that second tier turret. They have a pretty good minion wave halfway there. But I don't know if they have time. Maybe they just have too much money to spend at this point. 11.5 thousand gold in the lead right now. And still a flawless game of 8-0 as we just hit 30 minutes.
Yeah, no reason for SKT to risk any. Anything, just go back, return out here,
right.
Take another dragon, get four for yourself. And really, just the way they've been sitting in this 1-3-1 as Marin is trying to run away, Hojin comes in.
Beautiful hop, the whimsy from Smeb could get him there in time, but it's all about Kuro being there. That'll take him a lot more time. This gives SKT time to move out on the map. Marin staying alive for quite a bit. Yes, it's going to go to Kuro. And I guess SKT did not get too much out. Thought Marin might make it a little farther, but that was a good pickup.
First, a small sloppy mistake we've seen in this game from SKT.
Yeah.
Marin, shut out.
Just being a little bit too greedy for trade, I think, with Smeb.
He's getting Baron off of one member. Very good here for Ku. But still quite a bit of Baron to be used by the rest of the teams. Faker to the bot lane, but he's got to be wary now.
Yeah.
He does not have his teleport up, and you can see that.
And I'm looking at this Ash pick here for Prey. Normally he's a fantastic Ash player who's able to set up a lot of picks for his team.
That's four.
Obviously one of the reasons Ku Tigers value it so highly. But what SKT did in this game, that was very smart. First of all, Sivir, who can spell shield the arrow. Ash, Alistar, who can obviously pop his ulti. We talked about the Elise, who can propel up into the air. There was no easy target for Prey to hit. We mentioned this earlier. There's no easy target for him to hit in the mid lane. And that's normally how you stop a 1-3-1 with Ash. You say to the other team, if you split up in side lane to be hard engage mid and you die.
They're setting up a play.
This has to work.
Faker onto Kuro. We've seen this before. He dodges out. The minions in the mid lane gave him a bit of vision here, and it looks like he's going to be able to stay for the full fight. Hojin gets eaten up, and they're trying to get out of this. A cocoon right across the mid lane could keep someone in range, and it's going to hit Gorilla. That's going to be the fly-in from the rest of the team. The Grey Health and Wild Growth is on. Everything once again for Ku being used in defense when they want to try and get in offensively. And this is more push power coming in from SKT. A minion wave already prepped towards the top side. They're going to be able to do a lot of damage here.
Ku literally threw everything they could at Faker there, and they didn't even hit him.
Nope.
With a spell at that fight, this has been strangling from SKT. They're completely starving out Ku Tigers and just putting their stamp on this world champion.
Definitely angering the beast with that loss. SKT coming out much stronger. Maybe this is the Pandora's box. We see a Raptor Cloak on Wolf as well. They're going to be going for the turret. That's going to be an inhibitor. 45 seconds under Curl. Gorilla just came up. Does Ku have what it takes to keep their dreams alive for the Summoner's Cup? And it looks like SKT may give them some breathing room here as they start to back out. They want this one methodically.
Yeah.
They're not making any mistakes.
Ooh.
Wolf goes in. I don't know if the team was fully on board with that one, but he does save off any re-engage as well from Ku.
Same again for SKT. There's no reason to risk anything. We've seen some of the other games.
Right.
The team got a little bit too greedy, overextended, end up dying. Not in this one outside that one misplay Mario made. It's been a perfect game almost.
And a surplus of items now coming out from the side of SKT. We talked about the spell shield. Bang, if he misses it, he also has the Quicksilver Sash. Now Faker's got his Rabadons on top of everything else.
Yeah.
Dead Man's Plate on the Steric's Rage and a Banshee's Veil in the top lane. So many things to help them mitigate the crowd control in Ku's fight.
it just seemed like Ku invested everything onto the fact that they could always engage with Tahm, Kench, and Ashe, so they didn't need to bring double teleport. They could start these fights. But then they didn't realize how many members of SKT could avoid getting stunned by that arrow, and suddenly the 1-3-1 was going to be a thing. Double TP. There's just been no answer. In fact, it's so hard to play against, especially get that massive lead early on, which they did.
Yeah, and I mean, this game, if SKT closes out with this 13,000 gold advantage, is almost classic SKT. It's exactly the way they want to win the game. Nothing incredibly flashy. Faker dominates the opposition. Yep. They still make smart plays after that. They rotate around the map properly, and they just systematically starve out the opponent. Ku Tigers, last stand, two inhibitors down. Here SKT comes.
On the hunt, goes in. That's gonna be Hojin in a real sticky situation. He goes down, a full three-man Gnar ultimate. That's gonna be Smeb down now. Eyes onto the AD carry, but the support hits. It's gonna be Kuro out safely. Prey, however, has to run away from his base. SK Telecom looking to take down the final Nexus turrets. It does not look good for Kuro and his team. Ku Tigers are falling. SKT will be your first ever two-time World Champions! In an almost perfect run, the emotion on the team being felt. You could see it on Faker's face. An almost perfect run here for SKT. Thwarted one game, but come out the victors and get to hoist the Summoner's Cup a second time.
Faker, Bengi, and Koma, the repeat champions here. And if Faker's legacy wasn't cemented enough, that last performance on Rise, he made it look easy.
Faker, playmaker. He showed up, especially here in the last game, had a good final overall. Other members from SKT, we always have to highlight Bengi. In this game on Elise, had a massive impact, but Bang really for me as well as an AD carry. In these fights here, he's never the guy you talk about. When you look at SK Telecom, you look at the big names like Faker, Marin in the top lane. Bang is just consistent, always there for his team and doing well.
It's gotta feel good for these guys.
An amazing record throughout summer to the end of Worlds. 53-7. SKT puts up an amazing show.
Now they get to hoist that Summoner's Cup. Also, Ku Tigers, you saw them still in good spirits. They had such a tremendous year. But ultimately, this is the year of SKT. Two LCK championships, spring and summer. Perhaps the most dominant split or total year we've ever seen from a Korean team. And it all culminates with that 13-1 slaughter of Ku Tigers in game four.
I think one of the biggest things you mentioned before, gentlemen, is the fact that the slump in game three wasn't even seen in game four. They knew exactly how to repair any of the errors and bring themselves right back to the top of the game.
That's when you know it's a great team. When you can lose a game in a best out of five and then instantly
fix
everything, you're ready for the next game.
I can't believe how much restraint SKT has. Just grab it.
As a team, they will do so. SK Telecom T1, your two-time world champions. An amazing feat that they have performed here at Worlds.
Yeah, because coming into this Worlds, there was a lot of hype for some of the other teams. EDG, LGD, even KT, Fnatic, CLG, all these teams that people thought could make a big appearance. And everyone fell short, except SKT, who I think completely lived up to expectations.
Absolutely.
As the favorite of this tournament. Even exceeded them in many of the positions, because Marin had huge games. Bengi had big games. Bang had huge games. And it wasn't until the very end that Faker actually had his big game.
The kiss of the LCK Cup and the Summoner's Cup for Faker once again. And right now we're going to throw it over to our analysts for a discussion of that game.
Thank you, Riv. Once again, our 2015 World Champions, SK Telecom, and so well deserved. It can only be reiterated. these guys have looked unstoppable throughout the year, unstoppable throughout this tournament, and they come away with it in such fashion there with that final game, absolutely taking over the Rift.
Well, they were a little bit stoppable. They did lose
MSI. That's right, you're right. They had the one blemish. They had the one loss.
It was an important international tournament, but I really respect them. They bounced back so hard after that. That one loss, they really came through, tried to fix the flaws that they found, and that led to this unbelievable 53-7 bloodbath through the summer season that has culminated right here.
And their tournament has just been so clean. It took almost all the way till the finals till we saw any of these unforced errors, and there were only a couple of them.
Yeah, well, up until Marin kind of died there in the double, it was almost looking like, except for one tower, a perfect game here. There's still some respect from McCrowley for the Blue Tigers.
Yeah. And from SKT as well, great sportsmen there, showing love for our runners-up. I mean, what an incredible run they had as well. That can't be forgotten.
But I really love it. You gotta love them. Look at their faces.
Talk about the attitude. The attitude that brought them to the finals will carry them out of the finals.
They may have lost, but they still had such an incredible year.
But they won our hearts.
They won our hearts.
Oh, by far and away.
Yeah, the first year that they're actually a professional team, they go all the way to the finals of the World Championship.
Right, we talked about, you know, great feats like Fnatic and Origin and having made it to the semis with their first year with these rosters. The same thing for KU Tigers when they make it all the way to the finals. They're the only team to take a game off of SKT in this tournament. But of course, taking only one game off of SKT, I mean, they remain these titans. And you refer back to the video we had at the beginning of the day talking about a team won the Season 3 World Championships, then goes into a slump in that Season 4 to some degree, and they come back stronger than ever.
Yeah, they're just fearless in their gameplay too, just no hesitation. I think the most I've seen SKT hesitate is when they actually like don't want to drop the cup when they're lifting it up. You know, that's like, okay, we're really good at this game, League of Legends, but this cup right here, you know, that's heavy. So, but
the overall is more difficult.
Yeah,
that cup is.
I've never deserved touch it. You know, so.
They're calculated in the way that they lift the cup, just like they're calculated in the way that they play.
Eventually, they'll get used to it. You know, this may not be the last summer's cup that the SKT organization may take home, because there's nothing really showing why they should stop progression. That's the more important part for me, is a team that stays flexible through multiple patches. I mean, they've had like 4 OGN titles, 2 worlds right now, and they've adapted to every meta. They've played to their strengths. They've slumped and came back, which is something barely any team does in League of Legends overall. So that is, for me, most impressive.
Their roster is just so well-rounded that the meta shifts, no matter which lane it shifts to, no matter what combo it can shift to, SKT have someone there that can carry.
And we really just saw that even in a microcosm in these finals, because look at what happened with Faker in this last game. He plays a couple games of Lulu, all right, let's help everybody else out. But then he has one of the most impressive Ryze games I have ever seen. He was seemingly everywhere on the map at once.
When he teleported mid, is like, did we glitch or something?
What is he doing there?
SKT getting their swag on right now. Got to get, you know, decked out in all of that World Finals gear as the newest champions. But I do want to return to what you guys are saying. This microcosm that we saw in the series itself, you know, and I do want to point again towards Koma and the coaching staff, because we've talked about, one, these are the guys, yes, who are out there doing the work, you know, individually and as a team, but behind them they have this backbone. They have SK Telecom as an organization, which is so well established, and it shows in the way that they can rebound from their first loss in Worlds and then have their most dominating game of the series.
It helps when you have Faker. So.
That as well.
It's a large advantage.
Another fitting way for this series to end was with Faker playing Ryze and still nobody having an answer for
it. The best part is that so many people, even in that game, underestimated what Faker could do on Ryze. There are so many moments where people are going to try and kill Faker and he just turns it around in 2-versus-1 scenario.
That is something,
multiple times.
Yeah, when you watch SKT as an analyst, very often you see the ideal plays and you just want the teams to make them. Very often when I'm watching SKT, I'm trying to understand what they're doing with the average viewer. Like, even as an analyst, I'm like, that makes sense. Pretty smart. And they do that in the moment with only half the vision on the map, shot calling it, everybody on the same page. It shouldn't be possible. It's not allowed. You know, you shouldn't be that good at League.
And Monty, you must find solace in the fact that no team was able to find an answer for Rise. So as I ask you that question, what is the counter? It is still unanswered.
Yes.
Of course. Now, when we look at the tournament holistically, there was one player that distinguished himself from the rest of the field, and that was SKT's unstoppable top laner, Marn. He had a 4.4 KDA over the tournament, the highest GPM of top laners, and the highest average CS lead at the end of all starting players. So really just, you know, being that rock for the team in general, being the shot caller, but two, creating these huge advantages for himself and leading the charge individually.
I gotta be honest, this guy does it all. In lane, in the early game, coming into this game here, he had the highest gold advantage of any player at Worlds at 10 minutes. And then he transitioned that into a massive macro game where he's constantly denying information, shoving waves, coordinating with his team when and where to pressure the map and earn these early leads for them.
And let's talk about Marin as a player over the course of his career, because when he came into SK Telecom, he was such a hyped solo queue player. This is going to be the Faker of the top lane. He likes to roam. He likes to come into the mid lane and help out the jungler with ganks. But then he came in, and he was a great Rumble player, and he was a great Renekton player, but he didn't have a lot of depth. He frequently overextended in the split push and got himself killed. But this year has really been the birth of Marin as a top-tier top laner, where he really deepened his champion
now.
Pool. He was just in his cocoon before, and now he's a beautiful Marin butterfly. That's very good.
The growth for him has been phenomenal, and you know, as much as we put weight on the fact that Bengi and Faker have achieved their second world championship, we have to look at those individuals who, you know, have just hit their first, and Marin being a huge example of that. Well, we'll continue this discussion in just a bit, but first, we're going to send it over to Shox for a word with our newly crowned champions.
Well, thank you very much. We will talk to them in a second, but first, join me in welcoming Trevor Henry, Brandon Beck, and Mark Marler for the presentation of the championship medals. Of course, our champions will get their medals, starting off with Faker himself. Fantastic performance all tournament long. Followed up by Bengi, his second world championship, ruling the jungle. And then Marin, what a tournament he's had. Most valuable player. Exceptional tournament. The AD carry bang, a 16 KDA, that's the highest out of all the starting players here. And his support, Wolf, and honestly, the backbone of SKT in their run to their second world championship. Not to forget, Easyhoon stepping up to the plate, a star in his own right. And getting the applause he deserves. Koma, the coach, leading SKT to their second world championship. And Carter, the head coach of SKT, behind the scenes, making it all happen. Well, we can talk to our champions now, starting off with Faker. We'll just hand over the mic. Faker, I mean, congratulations. What a fantastic run. Can you try and explain to me, after all you've been through with this team, what it means to now be able to hoist the Summoner's Cup for the second time in your career?
Faker 선수 우선 우승을 정말 축하드립니다. 정말 멋진 대회를 이제 기록했는데요. 이제 지금 현재 있는 SKT1 팀과 이제 여러 가지 일들을 정말 많은 일을 함께 같이 겪었는데 이렇게 두 번째로 소환서컵을 들어올린 소감이 어떠신가요? 어떤 의미가 있나요, 페이커 선수한테?
제가 이전에 우승했을 때는 그렇게까지 큰 기쁨이 없었는데 지금은 정말로 기쁘고 또 그때는 과거였지만 지금은 현재라서 더 기쁜 것 같습니다.
So back when I won my first Summoner's Cup, I wasn't as happy as right now, but and past is past and this is present, so I feel much happier right now.
Well, Faker, to say that everyone has noticed it as well. You just seem more and more relaxed this year. You even did a somersault before the game began. Can you talk us through the experience next to the stage as well and the fun you've had here?
페이커 선수 이번 대회 때 더욱더 여유로운 모습을 많이 보이겠다고 이제 얘기를 들었는데 아까 이제 입장하실 때도 구르기를 선보일 정도로 되게 더욱더 퍼포먼스가 화려해졌습니다. 이번 대회 도중, 대회를 진행하면서 어떠한 경험들을 했는지 말씀해 주세요.
제가 한국에 있을 때는 여기에 있을 때보다 별로 컨디션이 안 좋았었는데 막상 로이드컵을 오고 나니까 한국에 있을 때보다 더 잘 되는 거예요. 그래서 기분도 좋고 또 여러 가지 모습을 보여줬던 것 같습니다.
So back when I was in Korea, I didn't feel as good. I mean, I didn't feel that well, and I don't think I performed as well. But after coming here at Worlds, I think I was playing much better, and I just felt a lot better. So I felt like I'd show much more myself to the crowd and fans.
That you did. With that, Faker, you still had to play out the full games. It came to four games, no undefeated run for you guys. Can you tell me how you guys went from game three to game four? Was your confidence shaken at any point?
이제 4경기까지 가면서 결국 전승 우승이 이제 깨지고 좀 어려움을 갖고 있었는데 3경기에서 이제 지셨을 때 좀 자신감이 흔들리거나 4경기에 들어갔을 때 어떤 망가짐으로 임했는지 말씀해 주세요.
저희가 이번 롤드컵에서 처음으로 진 거기 때문에 모두가 상심이 컸지만 그렇지만 모두 힘내서 다시 4경기 때는 원래 플레이하던 대로 했던 것 같고 3경기 때 졌을 때 저는 전승 우승이 깨져가지고 우승을 해도 별로 기쁘지 않을 것 같았는데 막상 우승하니까 아무런 생각도 안 하고 그냥 이겼다는 거에 기쁜 것 같습니다.
So at first, this was our first loss in the tournament, so all our teammates, we felt really bad. But he said, let's cheer up once more, and we went back to our original play style. And at first, personally, when I lost the third game, I thought I wouldn't be as happy because our perfect record was broken. But after we won, I just didn't remember any of that third game, and it just felt really good.
And you guys closed it out. Finally, for Faker, before we talk to Bengi as well, is there anything you want to say to all the fans watching back in Korea and around the world and here who have supported you for the last couple of weeks?
이제 마지막으로 여기 현장에 와주신 팬들이나 전 세계에서 페이커 선수와 SKT1 팀을 응원해준 팬들한테 한마디 말씀 부탁드립니다.
Hi guys. I have so much to tell you, but my English is not good, so thank you and thank you for sharing and always love me.
Obviously, they love you here as well, Faker. Thank you very much. But we also need to talk to Bengi. Congratulations. I mean, what a fantastic tournament. Also, your second world championship. Has it sunken in yet that you've been able to do this two times in the last couple of years?
그 벵기 선수 우선 우승을 축하드리고요. 아직 실감이 안 날 수 있지만 어쨌든 지금 2회째 우승을 차지하셨습니다. 우승 소감을 말씀해 주세요.
일단 2회째 우승이라는 게 너무 고맙고 좀 팀원들에게 좀 감사해요. 제가 아무래도 결승전 때 좀 안 좋은 모습을 보였다고 생각하기 때문에 아무래도 이 경기도 제가 실수한 것 때문에 힘들었고 3경기 때도 저로 인해 좀 힘들었고 그래서 팀원에게 너무 미안하다는 생각이 좀 많네요.
First, I want to say thanks to my teammates. Personally, I think I haven't performed that well during this final series. I think our team struggled during the second and third game because of me. So I'm really sorry for my teammates and also thankful at the same time.
Well, Bengi, even with that very self-critical but a fantastic tournament for you and your team after all, how have you lived kind of the last couple of years? Because we know that you haven't had the easiest time last year around. It still must mean a lot, even if you're doubting yourself at this moment.
지금 정말 최고의 순간이지만 이제 작년에는 조금 팀 전체적으로 힘든 순간도 있었고 이제 지난 여기까지 우승하기까지 지난 시간의 여정을 좀 말씀해 주세요.
일단 처음에는 지는 게 어렵다고 생각할 정도로 첫 시즌은 잘 보냈어요. 롤드컵 우승도 했고 그 해를 완벽하게 보냈으니까. 근데 그 다음 해를 보냈을 때는 정말 절망적일 정도로 바닥을 쳤고 그 다음에 자신감도 없는 상태에서 솔직히 은퇴할까도 생각했는데 아무래도 코치님이 한 시즌만 더 해보자 계속 설득해 주셔서 한 시즌을 더 보냈는데 그런 저를 설득해 준 코치님한테 감사하게 여기고 싶어요.
So like at our first year, we were playing so well. Losing seemed even harder than winning. So we even won the world championship. But last year, we had a very abysmal year. Like we had a very hard time. I even thought of retiring. But my coach talked me into it, and he told me to let's just play one more season. Let's play together one more time. And I just want to say thanks to Koma, my coach, for grabbing me once more and helping me come back to my own pace.
With that, Bengi, is there anything you want to say to all the fans that have been supporting SKT through bad times and very, very good times?
뱅기 선수도 어쨌든 SKT1이 힘든 시절부터 지금까지 응원해준 모든 SKT1 팬들에게 한마디 말씀해주세요.
일단 저는 영어가 짧아서 영어로는 말 못할 것 같고 저희가 잘할 때나 못할 때나 항상 응원해준 팬분들에게 감사하게 여기고 싶고 또 유럽에서 응원해준 팬분들에게 감사하게 여기고 싶습니다.
I wish I could speak in English, but my English is not too good. I want to say thanks to all our fans who supported us during our bad times and good times. And I also want to say thanks to all the European fans who cheered us throughout the whole month. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Bengi. Thank you very much, Faker. We'll be talking to some more members of SKT in just a little bit. But ladies and gentlemen, one more time for your 2015 League of Legends World Champions, SK Telecom T1.
From Faker, rather. You know, for him to say that the last one didn't mean as much as this one. The past is the past. The present is the present, right? That is a champion's mentality, looking forward to this series and putting as much weight on it. So many people would be willing to say, well, I've won one before. I can rest on my laurels there. And he doesn't do that. He comes back in and wins it in spectacular fashion.
Yeah, just being able to get first person ever to combine with Bengi there just to get two cups, you know, nobody.
Ankoma, if we're talking about repeats, yeah. Let's give credit.
We're going to go into semantics here, yeah.
Well, and then on Bengi's side, the modesty that comes from him in victory there, saying that he didn't feel he played his best game, you know, but it really was a team effort. And then two, to stretch to Koma and say that I was looking at retiring, but again, this points to the organization, the strength of them as a team staying together.
Yeah, and SKT just as a lineup are very modest, you know, when they have winning matchups, they don't really go the style on their opponents. They just play clean League of Legends with the necessary amount of respect, and then they just end the game. Sometimes it's not as exciting because they could go for all these weird picks and still win the game because they're so good at the game. But
and now, of course, it's time for a celebration.
Swag time!
Swag time! As the players of SK Telecom get to finally celebrate with the rest of the people here in the arena. I'm sure things are about to get loud and crazy.
Can I go down there?
I did one of those shirts.
You want to just scream at the desk real quick and I'll just, you know, peace
yeah,
out?
Yeah, you know what? I'll hold down the desk, Krupa. You go join them down there for the party. Seriously, I got to get my hands on one of those shirts. What's going on?
Easy Hoon and Wolf getting in on it as well. Easy Hoon, great performance from him as well. It's got, I mean, some people might think it's hard to be on a team where the person with your spot on the starting lineup is Faker.
That was a great interaction there.
He pulls it off so well.
Well, Isihoon too, we talk about the last finals that SKT played against the Koo Tigers, and he was the man in charge. The Faker sat on the bench for the entire finals during that 3-0 performance, and he's been absolutely crucial to this team because it allows them, it makes it so hard to prepare against them. They can play Isihoon, and he's so good at these control mages that it really changes up your pick ban strategy.
And they're spearheading the trend where teams are starting to get really inclusive with their substitutions. At the start of League of Legends teams, subs were only people you put on the piece of paper just to have in emergencies. Yeah. You know, sometimes they were Diamond 3, but SKT, they take that a step further, you know, have their subs ready to fill in. You know, they have players like Isihoon who could easily be rated as top 5 mid laners in the world on their bench, you know, so unlucky for him, he has Faker to go up against there, so that's really cool that they're so inclusive of him, even in the post-game celebration, for example. They're a team.
It's another thing that puts SKT even further ahead of the competition, that they're already fielding a six-man roster with rotating that roster and actually getting a lot of value out of Isihoon.
Yeah, and I think that's where you end up looking to other teams now and what they end up taking away from this experience at Worlds, from both their own experiences, but as well as from witnessing the achievements of SKT. Clearly, this organization is doing something right to have won 2 in the last 3. All right, well, now we're going to send it over to the stage where Shox is joined once again by SKT's coach and our 2015 Worlds MVP.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Joined here by Koma, the coach for SKT. You can keep the hat on if you want. Well, Koma, I want to start by congratulating you, 2-time world champion with SKT. And I want to start by talking about something Bengi said, how you were so instrumental in helping him get back up there together with the rest of the team. Can you tell me about your experience about these guys who were quite down last year, bringing them all the way back up and winning the Summoner's Cup?
그 코치님 우선 SKT 팀과 2회 우승을 거두신 걸 축하드리고요. 방금 인터뷰에서 뱅기 선수가 본인이 힘들어할 때 코치님이 도움을 다시 한번 팀과 다시 힘을 내서 경기를 할 수 있다고 얘기를 했었는데 코치님이 어째 이러한 팀을 SKT1 팀을 힘들 때를 겪어서 다시 정상까지 올리기까지 어땠었는지 말씀해 주세요.
일단 과정 같은 경우 처음부터 이야기하면 너무 길어서 힘들 것 같고요. 일단 뭐 이런 결과 나오기까지는 정말 많은 노력과 정말 많은 노력, 네, 눈으로 보지 않고서는 정말 몰라요. 뭐 피드백 할 때나 뭐 이런 아무튼 정말 힘든 과정이 있었습니다. 이런 우승은 그냥 운으로 온 게 아니고요. 정말 선수들이 노력한 만큼 나았었던 것 같습니다. 선수들이 정말 굉장히 노력했습니다.
I wish I could tell the full story, but it's too long, so I'm gonna skip that. And like coming up to this point, it's just, I don't know, it's really hard to explain in a couple words. We put in so much effort, we had endless feedback sessions, and players practiced so hard. The players came up to this position as a champion, once again, not through luck, but their own practice and effort. And overall, I think it's all because of the players, how much they dedicate themselves into this game and this sport.
Well, dedicate themselves, they did, and Homa, it begs the question, 2 world championships in the very young history of League of Legends, 5 years, you naming those players how strong they are, we know what you can do with them. What does that make you think in terms of the possible world championships that SKT could take in the future?
그 이제 이 5회밖에 진행 안 된 이 짧은 월드 챔피언십 기간 동안에 SKT는 무려 2회나 우승을 거뒀습니다. 근데 이제 코치님 말씀하신 것처럼 이렇게 연습 열심히 하고 정말 강한 선수들이 팀에 있는데 이제 앞으로 미래에 SKT1이 다시 한번 월드 챔피언십에 결승 우승하기까지 어떤 가능성도 어떻게 될 것 같은지 말씀해 주세요.
예, 재작년에 뭐 윈터 전승 우승하고도 했었던 말인데 물론 내년에 뭐 떨어질 수도 있긴 하지만 팬분들이 응원을 해 주신다면 이 무대 언제든지 올라오겠습니다. 팬분들 항상 아낌없는 격려와 응원 부탁드리겠습니다. 팬분들이 계신다면 이 자리에 꼭 다시 올라오겠습니다.
So after we won Winter 2014 LCK, the perfect record, during the winner interview, I said that even though we're at this top of the mountain, we might fall and we might have some hard times, but if we have the fans there to cheer for us during our bad time and they keep on rooting for us, we can climb back up. I'm gonna say that again.
So we're at the top of the mountain right now, but I just want to say that, ask for our fans to keep on cheering for us and keep on rooting for us so we can, even though you might have some hard times in the future, with those fans, we can also once again bounce back up.
And they always will. Thank you very much, Koma. Congratulations, the coach, after reaching his second world championship. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Shox. And that's a guy right there that I want to sit down with for a couple hours and really just get his full philosophy and thoughts on coaching, because the work he's done with this young crew of guys has been just phenomenal to watch.
Gonna need a translator, though.
I will need it.
I have actually had the joy of talking to Koma in like an informal setting, rather, just while getting some translation, and he's like hilarious. He's a super nice guy. Every time you meet him just outside of the venue, he's always smiling. So Koma is just actually so good of a person that it makes you annoyed. You know, why can't I be more
like
Koma?
You're a good human being. You're successful. What is this?
You're good at League of Legends.
You're everything Crepo isn't. What is going on?
Comes full circle.
I love you, buddy. but, you know, again, we have to reflect, and he talked about it there, the organization itself, you know, looking forward, the future of SK Telecom is such a young esport here, League of Legends, and they've already got two of the five world championships. I mean, that's quite a trophy case, but they're also building up quite a bit of expectation for themselves now moving forward.
Yeah, I mean, there's one more thing that they could do. They could actually not drop any games. They only dropped a single one. So at least they left room for improvement. I think that was the idea.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. So now when they go back to the team house later, they can be like, all right, so we clearly have things to work on.
Yeah, what are we working for next season?
Yeah.
Less losses.
Yeah, exactly. Don't go run 5-man into the jungle and give up 5 kills in the first 5 minutes. But if we can avoid that, we'll probably be good. I feel like, you know, aside from that, when we look at the run that this team has made throughout Worlds, you know, they really should walk away, though, even with that blemish. ignoring the fact that it wasn't perfect, because that shouldn't be what they, you know, end up hanging their hats on. It should be that dominating fashion that they won.
I mean, they messed up a couple lane swaps, you know. But at this point, I'm not sure whether they messed them up or whether I'm too dumb to realize what they were actually doing at that point. I'm like, you didn't bounce the wave, SKT, you made a mistake, but maybe it's, you know, they've shown the late game shot calling is so good that I'm starting to question my own sanity when it comes to, like, watching them.
You're not
like,
making a good case for yourself for a new coach. I don't know, man.
I'm not looking to coach. I'm looking to stay here.
You want to stay right here where it's okay to be wrong?
Yes.
So you're just not seeing the long game of the 3-minute setup of the wave bounces back and forth a few times, and then that's where the play comes
of
in.
Of course.
It's all calculated.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
It's the 25-minute setup till the Nexus explosion. The entire plan.
Well, one last time, we have another interview back down to Shox, who's standing by with SKT's man in the top lane.
Thank you very much, Wonshuk. Good and dash. Standing by with Maren, as said, the MVP. And well, for Faker and Bengi, their second world championship. It was his very first world championship, and immediately a win. Congratulations. What are your first thoughts after hoisting that cup, being here for the first time and going all the way with your team?
그 마린 선수 우선 첫 월드 챔피언십 우승을 축하드리고요. 우승 직후에 이제 소환사 컵을 처음 들어올렸을 때 무슨 생각을 하셨나요?
네, 일단 저희가 페이커 선수랑 벵기 선수들은 이제 2회째 우승이긴 한데 나머지 선수들은 이제 첫 우승이라 정말 더 기뻤고 그래서 소환사 컵을 들었을 때 이제 우승했다고 실감이 들었어요.
So even though it's Faker and Bengi's second world championship, for the rest of us it's our first. So we were all so happy and we were we really enjoyed that moment. And when we hoisted that World Championship Cup, Summer's Cup, that at that point it struck me that, oh, we're the world champions.
That must have given you, maybe not yet, but some time to reflect on your own performance. Your teammate Bengi was saying how he wasn't that satisfied with his own play. You have been impeccable throughout the tournament. Our analysts crowned you most valuable player. How do you reflect on how you've done?
그 뱅기 선수는 이전 인터뷰에서 이번 결승전 때 그리고 이번 대회 동안 본인의 활약에 대해서 좀 만족하지 못한다고 얘기를 했었는데 마린 선수는 이번 대회 정말 엄청난 활약을 계속 보여줬었고 이번 대회 끝나고 이제 분석가 데스크에서 이번 대회 MVP를 꼽혔습니다. 본인의 활약을 이번 대회 동안에 어떻게 평가하시나요?
네, 일단 제가 이번 시즌 롤드컵에서 잘한 부분도 있고 못한 부분도 있는데 못한 부분이 좀 있음에도 이번 시즌에 MVP로 뽑아주셔서 정말 감사하고요. 내년에도 롤드컵에 나와서 이번 시즌에 아쉬운 점들을 더 보완해서 내년에는 좀 퍼펙트한 마린으로 돌아올 수 있었으면 좋을 것 같아요.
So even though I had some good plays and bad plays throughout this tournament, I want to thank everybody for naming me the MVP, the most valuable player of this tournament. And hopefully I want to come back next year once more. And I want to fix my flaws and come back as a more perfect Marin, perfect version of Marin.
Well, that will be very scary. we'll be waiting for you, Marin. Is there anything you want to say to all the fans here and all the SKT fans around the world?
그 마지막으로 여기 있는 SKT1 팬들과 전 세계에서 응원한 SKT1 팬들에게 한마디 말씀 부탁드립니다.
Thank you, everybody. I love you. 영어는 짧아서 이 정도만 하고요. 일단 SKT1이 세계적으로 제일 유명한 팀이 될 수 있었던 거는 그래도 팬분들의 응원이 정말 커서인 것 같고 그래서 정말 감사하다고 전하고 싶어요, 전 세계 팬분들에게.
Except for the English part.
Yeah.
I think without all of our fan support, SKT wouldn't have become like the world top esports pro team. So I want to say thanks to all of our fans.
And thanks to you, Marin, for an exceptional tournament. 감사합니다. Back over to you guys.
One last time, thank you, Shox. And congratulations to Marin again on achieving that Most Valuable Player award for this tournament in his first year. He really did lead this team, you know, and I think a lot of credit needs to be extended to him for doing it on a team of star players.
Well deserved. I mean, he stepped up in a meta that required it for his position, and absolutely he was the top performing top laner.
I mean, if you're going to share some chalk calling burden,
all right,
and
now
you gotta tell
I Faker. Have to give okay. some context here. Faker's holding a stalk of broccoli, and that's because a fan extended the offer to him and said, "Your hair looks like broccoli." So Faker said, "All right, well, if I win, I will eat some broccoli."
He did promise to eat broccoli.
So there it is, ladies and gentlemen.
Stay healthy.
The victory broccoli. That's better than the Summoner's Cup right there. That's got iron in it.
The true secret.
I love how they're explaining his story to you. He's like miming. He's like, this is my hair broccoli. I will now eat my hair.
He's like, that's some serious iron there.
It's just raw. He's going to do it.
That's the kind of minerals you need there, sir. That's what champions eat, is your broccoli.
That's the difference between a good and an exceptional rice player is the amount of broccoli you eat raw.
Yeah, it's not a Popeye thing. It's not spinach. It's broccoli, ladies and gentlemen.
Eat your vegetables, kids.
Look at us, distributing solid health messages around the world. All right, well, there they are again. It can only be reiterated so many times that these guys so much well-deserved for their journey through the year, the season, and the World Championships here. Now, it's been a long road for all of our teams, and we've gotten to witness a lot of epic moments on the road to the Summoner's Cup. What stands out to you guys specifically? Kobe, I'm going to start with you.
Being from North America, I'm going to have to go back to week one when there were happy times for us. And I have to point out Cloud9. They brought to brunt the power of the Morgana, Vhagar, Tristana, these siege comps from North America where we really found success. And then it all culminated in this amazing pentakill from Balls after he got so much criticism leading up to this. For him to accomplish that play on the first week and for them to go 3-0 was just sort of a magical moment.
Yeah, it was magical. And then they got super reverse swept, and that was the end of NA. 0-10, the dream.
You live by the reverse sweep.
All right, Crepo. Well, in classic EU fashion then, where are you pointing your finger for your favorite moment?
I wonder. I'm in Europe. Worlds is in Europe. You know what else was in Europe? Two European teams in a semi-final. No NA teams there at all. That was, for me, fantastic. I got to cast one of the games in Brussels, home country. For me, that was just, the rise from Origin, from a challenge. It was like from an unranked to challenger, came to full success there for Xpeke, and then Fnatic still bouncing back all the way to semi-final. Sadly, it was a full Korean final, but for me, this was like the highlight.
Well, thanks for mentioning my favorite thing too, right there. The All-Korean final.
What a surprise.
Your new favorite. I'm going to go a little bit more micro on this one. I really liked Gorilla's first Tahm Kench game versus CLG, because I had never seen Tahm Kench played at this level before, and the way that they got the early kills, the plays that they made on the map later, the flanks that Gorilla managed to get,
the
Flame Choppers combo. I was just so psyched. It's always a pleasure to see new champions come out, and then it takes some time for the pro players to figure them out, but when you start seeing them used at this level, it is such a pleasure for an analyst.
Yeah, that's what you call a bit of a Schadenfreude.
I don't know about this player right now.
This was saved by the beautiful Azir Maul.
I won that team back.
Yeah, because of the Azir.
Well, you know, this wasn't necessarily planned, but after hearing your guys' favorite moments, I'd like to hear what some of your favorite moments are at home. So go ahead and tweet into @LOLESports with the hash one last time with hashtag Worlds and let us know what your favorite moments are. You know, again, to reflect on your favorite moments. Of course, I'm with you, Kobe. Being from NA, I've gotta extend my hat to Cloud9 for at least being the pride of NA in week one. To your point, Crepo, I think absolutely a phenomenal showing from EU. When you look at the takeaways from this tournament, Korea and EU being the two regions that really stepped up, and two teams improving.
It's always a fantastic world when two European teams can make it to the semifinals, in my opinion.
I really have to congratulate all of the teams on the diverse strategies that they brought to this tournament, because there was such a big patch change. There were so many things that they could have gone with, you know, just try and copy SKT, try and copy the best team. Everybody just funnel on one strategy, but that did not happen. Everybody was trying new champions. Everybody was trying new strategies, and we eventually filtered out, you know, what was the best.
Well, it didn't happen, but it makes you wish the people had just picked up Ryze. For the love of God,
that will be one of the biggest
copy
mysteries.
Copy one thing from SKT, please. Well, while the Summoner's Cup has been claimed for another year, there's still more professional League of Legends to play out in 2015. Mark your calendars, because from December 10th through the 13th, top players from around the world will converge on Los Angeles, California, for the 2015 All-Star event. You'll be able to vote for your region's dream team in the coming weeks, so keep an eye out on lolesports.com. Now, it's been quite the journey, but now it's time to turn out the lights on the 2015 season as we look towards All-Stars and 2016. Congratulations to our champions, SK Telecom, and on behalf of all of us here working to bring the excitement of this year's World Championship to you, thank you for joining us over the last 5 weeks, and until next time, we'll see you on the Rift.
Good cast on a day.
I never thought we would be able to compete at Worlds.
Champion, Kostani's first week 0-3. How can he have so little time left now?
일단 저는 EDG랑 가장 만나고 싶었기 때문에 이번에 조 편성이 굉장히 잘 됐다고 생각하고.
In a battle that many people thought was a preview of the finals, SK Telecom T1 make it look easy.
Coming from a small country where, you know, nobody knew me to be here right now is really amazing.
Com certeza, o dia de hoje eu acho que é um dos dias mais importantes da minha vida. Um dia que a gente pode fazer história representando o Brasil.
Best showing of an international wildcard team ever at the World Championship.
Flash Wolves might just be Koo here. Koo Tigers, too far behind, can't do anything. What is up with the upsets? Cloud9 versus Fnatic, it's a long-standing rivalry here. Double kill for Paul, a triple kill for Paul. Holy cow, the Tigers again! The kill for Paul.
Week 2, Fnatic came to play.
It has been an absolute massacre of Cloud9 in this game.
Alistar's camping on the lantern.
Eyeball! Pickaboo!
My story ends here, but even with me gone, I still want everyone to support TSM and all of my teammates.
It's gonna be enough! There are no respawns! And Fnatic!
legitimate threats at every single part of the game.
There is no base left. There is only victory for AHQ. Ku Tigers have punched their ticket to the quarterfinals in London.
Me on one side and Deft on the other cannot possibly see it becoming anything less than a great game.
너무 빨리 만나게 된 것 같아서 좀 그랬어요.
It's a double for Reckless. He wants to run down more. Deft, his brother in arms, will be his dead man in arms. That's a triple. Fnatic will advance to the semi-finals. The only team to do that three times.
抽到 SKT 也是，如果你要打冠军，总会要遇到的。
Not gonna underestimate them at all. He's gonna be interesting.
He gets a quadra kill! He's on Dano! And it's gonna be all fun to save the game! Boom! The kills come in! And this could be the semi-finals for Origin!
그때도 쉽게 이긴 게 아니라 정말 어렵게 이겼기 때문에
In summer season, it was KT Rolster, but Ku with a chance at revenge. And there it is! Ku Tigers go to the semifinals!
SKT definitely looks like the best team right now. It's the best team, like being the underdog, because you have no pressure.
Soaz has to burn it preemptively, and he guesses right. Biggie goes the wrong way. There's no one around right now. He's still running away through the wards. Pop summoner teleport, and oh my god! Soaz makes the great escape! Is a god!
그 경기에서 많이 잘해서 우리를 좀 도서관처럼 만들어버렸으면 좋겠네요.
Rooney's gonna pick a fight once more with Smith. And Grand Challenge throws down. Smith flashes away from the third proc of the Broken Wings. Rooney will find a stun, but fails the flash. And Smith will be smiling with that one. Are you kidding me? Fnatic pulls out a miraculous fight. And it was a European eulogy as both EU squads drop at the semi-final stage.
We are gathered here today to mourn the death and celebrate the life of the European teams at the World Championship.
I think we had the potential, but not enough experience. We have a lot of depth to work on, and maybe next year. I'm really proud of them.
Faker wreaking havoc inside the base. There's no stopping him now. It's time for SKT to make it to the finals undefeated.
Themselves the ace, will get themselves the place, and
will hurl themselves a shot to the Summoner's Cup in Berlin against SK Telecom. They're well on track to become the most dominant Worlds performing team.
And the scary thing about it is how easy they have made it look. They have a chance to be the first real League of Legends dynasty.
And they take down Prey, they take down Gorilla, and it's just chaos. SKT is two wins away from the Summoner's Cup. Bang jumps over the wall for another kill, and it looks like it's gonna be an ace in the base. SK Telecom T1 are one win away from being your two-time world champions. That's the grand challenge on Bang.
For the first time, SKT is wounded.
We are the ones to ignite the darkened skies.
SKT, is it bringing their A game? Have they even opened up Pandora's box?
Faker and Kuro went hard.
Orchard, so there's no flash for this. Hojin in a real bad situation. He goes down a full three-man NAR ultimate. That's going to be SmackDown now. SKT will be your first ever two-time world champions.
Yeah.